For close to 10 years, the business community has been pushing Bank of Uganda to license banks that can operate under the Islamic banking principle. Of course, this has been on since 2013 when the conversation started. The argument was, if commercial banks are charging high interest rates, then why don't we work with Islamic banking principles that deem that when you take money, all you do is share the profits and don't pay principal or don't pay interests as other commercial banks operate. This has been a conversation for a very long time, and I should say it's a kudos to Bank of Uganda, finally 2023, and yes, the first bank has been licensed under the Islamic banking principle, which is Salam. Now, Salam currently operates in Kenya, Somalia, and Djibouti, and a 12-month period has been given to the bank to start operating here in Uganda. We can only hope to see how that turns out. But of course, there are principles that will be respected. For instance, if you are borrowing money to invest in piggery, it's a good venture, but you might not get that money because, remember, we said the principles of Islam are followed in Islamic banking operations. Welcome to the Business Show. My name is Simon. Thank you so much for making time. From wherever you're watching, we're glad you could make time. This is what's coming up on the show this week. Once again, welcome to the show. So let's get the show started this week. And this week we'll start with digital lending, which is the platform that allows you to take money without necessarily moving to your bank to meet the person at the front desk. The conversation has been, is there a possibility that we can access money without signing all these papers and whatnot? Of course, this is something that is interesting because I tell you what, it cuts down on the costs that are incurred in the transactions, but also convenience for you that is trying to get money. However, there are risks that must be addressed first. For instance, data that is shared is, in most cases, not really controlled by the bank or the financial institution that offers that money. This week on Views from the Top, we speak to Susan Mugoya, who is the head of risk at Letsteho, Uganda, and we are holding a conversation around digital lending inherent risks. What are some of the things that you need to pay attention to if you are to go into digital lending, or if you are supposed to, or you want to embrace digital lending as a way of taking money from the banks and not signing the paperwork forth and back? This is Views from the Top.
Welcome to the Business Show. My name is Susan Mugoya. I work with Letsteho Uganda, heading the Risk and Compliance Department. So lending is, it is a necessity for us because as a country, clearly we seem to be a low income sector country, and most of us need money. We have so many things that we need to do. Probably Susan wants to buy a car, she wants to put up housing, and with our incomes, it becomes difficult for me to be able to finance that from maybe my business or my salary. So when you have institutions that are able to lend you money, you bridge that gap. So as a business, we come in to support and see how we can bridge the gap for the consumers.
Talk about bridging the gap. I know you're directly into helping the small, I would call them small holder borrowers, for lack of a better word. What are some of the things you're doing for them to be part of the, you know, the borrowing chain and payback?
So we have simplified lending. We have digital lending, and then we have all sorts of loans. We are looking at a borrower who wants to invest something in their, maybe their small stall somewhere, but they are not able to borrow up to 100 million, which really usually the mainstream banking would take care of. So they rush to other institutions who will be able to support in that area. Then, of course, with that, We have, through digital lending, you're able to borrow as little as 100,000, 50,000. Mm. So you're able to run something quickly, maybe buy airtime, pay for a utility at home, you've run out of your car, you quickly need it, you're able to do that.
Okay. All right, so you do say digital lending or digital borrowing is the new thing now, but it comes with risks and you're in charge of risks. Mm. Talk us through this and what do you think should be done to protect the person borrowing?
So there are a number of risks. Of course, with anything comes so many risks. When you look at a person who is targeting you, as you innovate, someone else is also innovating to beat what you've put in place. Mm. So there are a number of risks that have come up with digital lending. We have over-indebtedness. People are borrowing. So if you're not going to meet Susan to process the loan, Susan is just borrowing over her phone. An average Ugandan has about two SIM cards. I'm talking about us, okay, the example of borrowing through the phone. Mm. An average Ugandan has two SIM cards. I'm going to borrow through my Airtel, then I'll borrow through my MTN, and then probably I have these other apps that are not mainly on the network, on the mobile operator's network, and I'll be able to borrow through those as well. Then, of course, I'm borrowing from my friend, I'm borrowing from the bank, I'm borrowing probably from the other microfinance institutions. So that leads us to over-indebtedness, and that requires a lot of monitoring. Then we have the exposures of fraud. We are all not very straight, like I mentioned. As you innovate, even the fraudster is innovating. How do I beat the system to see that I get something, I benefit, before they put proper measures in place? So there is exposure to fraud. And of course, cybersecurity. Anything that comes with technology, there's exposure to cybersecurity. Cybersecurity, we are looking at me as a consumer. Am I able to protect myself? I'm using my phone. We are in WhatsApp groups and we keep receiving messages. Someone is telling you, you have received this. If you click on this link, you'll receive maybe 50 MB. MTN is promoting this, or they are celebrating this anniversary. And as consumers, we should be able to pay attention to this and know that this could be a target. And you may think you're not going to lose money at that moment, but someone is collecting your information. They are targeting you, and they can use that for anything. Then, of course, there are high interest rates. If we are not regulated, we have everyone coming up with an app to lend to consumers, and there is no regulation following them up, definitely we are going to have our consumers duped. Then, of course, that also speaks to consumer protection. Who is protecting the consumer? And that is a very big risk. Then, of course, there is also vulnerability to money laundering. As Uganda, we are still on the grey list for money laundering. Mm. And if these digital lenders are not regulated and they are not monitored, then it becomes very difficult. It exposes the country to money laundering, plus the service provider. You who is providing the service, do you know who you're dealing with? Are you able to check and confirm that if I'm dealing with a one Susan, I'm able to check and confirm that this is a genuine person, or they are using me for money laundering? There are really so many risks around that, but those are some that I can quickly mention to our viewers.
Okay, so do you think in terms of regulation, enough has been done to maybe sensitize the borrowers, but also generally protect those that are using phones? So.
Well, something has been done, but there's a lot more that needs to be done to sensitize the consumer plus the person providing the service. Because we are all exposed. The consumer is exposed and the service provider is exposed. So we have some regulators in place who are able to help us, and we need to take that step as the consumers as well. If I'm using a service, have I taken the time to understand where this service is coming from. Is it a genuine person? As Ugandans, we easily trust. If a person comes and tells me, Susan, I'm selling ABCD, I'll quickly run with it. But do I take the time to understand where it's coming from? So the onus is on us to be able to do our background checks. If I'm saying I'm lending money, then definitely there has to be a regulator who regulates me and controls my operations. And some of the regulators that we have in place, we have the Financial Intelligence Authority. It looks at the intelligence, basically, money laundering, terrorism financing, and as Uganda, we are being attacked by the terrorists so much. So that helps us to be able to regulate and see if one organization is receiving money from people, what measures have they put in place? The regulation puts thresholds in place. If I'm going to pay your loan and I'm paying above a certain threshold, which is 1,000 currency points, and currency points is an equivalent of 20,000. If I'm paying you that and required by the regulator, that is Financial Intelligence Authority, to report that to the regulator that I've received this money from this person. It may be a genuine payment, but my role as a person, as a provider, is to report that. Then we have the Uganda Microfinance Regulatory Authority, which regulates the Tier 4 money lenders, SACOs, and their role is to really ensure that all these institutions are regulated. And from my knowledge and what I've been reading, they are doing some regulations, they're preparing some regulations for digital lending, which should be out in December, I think.
Okay.
Then we have, of course, NITA. NITA looks at data privacy. If I'm putting my information out there, I'm borrowing through your institution, I have I'm giving you my date of birth, I'm giving you my phone number, you have my address, you have all this information about me. How are you protecting that information? Because it is sensitive for me. So it is very important that the regulators that are in place are utilized. And for the consumer out there, you should be able to check and confirm. For example, if I'm going to borrow from a certain institution, I should be able to confirm that this institution is regulated. The regulators actually, for example, UMRA publishes annually the list of people who are institutions that have been regulated. Even when you visit their websites, you're able to get that information. So it is my responsibility as a borrower to check and confirm that actually the institution I'm dealing with is regulated and I'm protected as a consumer.
Right, so technology is seen as what, the next big thing, and as an opportunity for businesses to cut on costs of operations. So as we talk about whether or not as a country are ready to go that direction, what are some of the signs, the red flags as well, that show people that, wait, before you do ABCD, first check, this might be a fraudster or something?
So the biggest red flag is the institution regulated? Is it registered somewhere? If I receive an advert as I'm scanning through my Facebook or my YouTube and I'm requested to borrow, there's this juice amount that I'm looking for and it appears on my screen that I'm able to borrow, I should first stop and confirm, is this institution regulated? If it is not regulated, or if it is regulated, then where is their address? Because it's a requirement that any institution, why an organization should have an address. Even Zoom, that provides online services, has an address. So it is important to confirm that there's an address for that institution that you're trying to deal with. Yeah.
And what would it take for our businesses to fully embrace technology? What are some of the things you think you need to be, done to, for us to go digital, really?
So we need a lot of sensitization. we need to ensure that the consumers understand. But then we also need to understand, ensure we have proper controls in place. We are teaching our staff, and then the staff are also able to sensitize the consumer. What risks am I exposed to when I borrow over the phone? If I don't know those, you're just coming to tell me. You know, there's always been that saying that mainstream banking, they'll tell you, sign here, sign here, sign here. But are you teaching me, as I sign this document, what does it entail? Am I able to see the interest rate in there? Or you're just after having that sale and getting the business in your bag and forgetting about me? So it is our role to sensitize the consumer so they know what they are dealing with and the risks that they're exposed to.
So I guess it's clear to you now that is, if you are looking to take that money from the financial institutions, it's possible to do things at your convenience. But remember, the information that you share about yourself, where you stay, what you do, your name, your phone number, sometimes is not actually controlled by the financial institution entirely. So you're going to expose this information out there. And how many times have people called you back and told you you've won money and, you know, somehow it's not true, but it's because they linked you, they accept if your information without your permission. And also, if you're going to engage in these platforms, how many times do you get notifications from different money lenders, apps on your phone telling you can get 50 million, 10 million in 5 minutes, in 2 minutes, just a click and you have that money. On the Business Show, I want to tell you, listen, it's important to get money when you need it, but it's more important to pay attention to these things. Why should you click a button and go into apps that you don't understand who regulates them? And of course, we hope that the government can move into seeing how they can regulate these apps to ensure that for those formal institutions that are offering money digitally, they are not constrained by such crooks, I should say, that are frustrating the industry. You're watching The Business Show with me, Simon Tai. Now, for a quick break on the program, stay with us. In the meantime, feel free to get in touch with us as well. The conversation is on Twitter and Facebook. The handles are right below your screen. So we'll see you shortly. Stay with us.